I think once we start settling down, it'll create an osmosis effect. Okay. We had also have a dwindling audience in the afternoon after the after lunch and photographs. But welcome to those who are still here in the room. First of all, many thanks to Jim and the TTCSP program and ORF for organizing this session. I was discussing over tea in the morning that, you know, this being the third edition, I think I missed the second one. I had attended the first one. We should really collectively aim to scale up the Indian think tank forum on an annual basis. For an economy that at least aspires to be about $5 trillion in about a decade from now, I think at least proportionate to per capita and per capital, we are actually a very small think tank community. So the absolute numbers of think tanks that your annual report reports is actually an understatement of or an overstatement of what we should be actually doing together. So thanks for your continued efforts, Jim, and I hope we can all take up the mantle in our own ways. In the session that we have right now, as chair, I will try and keep it efficient and save us about 15 minutes at the end of it. Instead of a 1.5 hour session, we'll keep it to 1 hour, 15 minutes. But I've also requested the esteemed panelists to keep their initial remarks brief so that we can have as much of a discussion as possible. The session we have is titled Think Tanks and SDGs, the Sustainable Development Goals, Catalysts for Ideas, Analysis, and Implementation. Those of you who engage on this subject would be familiar that you know, the SDGs are like a broad church. They include everything that we can dream of. The MDGs tried to include everything and left a few things aside. So this time around, we've tried to put everything into the house, except we don't know which part might form the foundation, which part would be the living room, and which part would form the roof. But more, I mean, jokes aside, more critically, what should be the role of think tanks? You know, in 2 weeks from now, when Jim brings out his report, he's constantly been emphasizing all day, you know, what is the role of data and facts in a world of alternative facts? And that is not just the pathology of just one country. Actually, we all hide behind one country to disguise our own pathologies of deliberately either not looking for facts or choosing to ignore them. So when we have 17 goals and 169 targets, what should we chase? What should we chase? And how should we go about measuring progress? And what would be the role of think tanks, especially in that fluid environment where the present matters, but also keeping an eye on the future matters? A couple of weeks ago, I wrote my monthly column and titled it Grand Bargain for Sustainable Growth. And I kept in mind the upcoming elections and the likelihood that regardless of which party comes to power or comes back into power, there will be a call for new ideas. And that's exactly what think tanks should be preparing themselves for. So my offering was that at least as a polity, India should be trying to strike a grand bargain. One part of that bargain would be, can we drive our economic growth and jobs creation, our intention to become not just an emerging economy, but an emerged economy, through a substantial part of it coming from sustainable drivers? Whether it's 30% or 40%, we are at about $2.8 trillion today, or 2.5, depending on how you count. If we're going to be $5 trillion, we are going to add about $2.2 trillion to our economy over the next decade or 15 years. Can 30%, 40% of that come from what we would call sustainable drivers? And that's not just renewable energy, but a broad understanding of what sustainable development would be. But the other part of that grand bargain, and I had in mind the riots that happened in France, just in late November, December, that selling sustainability to the polity is going to be as important as selling sustainability to the policy makers, right? And if we don't get it right, and we tax or price our resources in inequitable manner, that the externalities are internalized, but the burden is imposed on those who feel they are more disadvantaged, then it's going to become a harder sell. So the second part of the grand bargain has to be able to embed equity in how we price or subsidize resources and externalities. But that was the kind of grand story I wanted to put out. What I will do is turn to my esteemed colleagues from IRADe and from the Institute of Economic Growth. First, we will go with Dr. Rohit Magotra, and then we'll turn to Dr. Manoj Panda. And I've requested them to offer their insights on this broad issue for the first 7 or 8 minutes. And then we'll still have about 50-odd minutes to have a discussion amongst ourselves. So let's just keep in mind this broader kind of sword that hangs over us, that we are asked for our answers, especially when governments change, but our answers have to be very much in tune with what the polity needs. Over to you, Rohit. Yeah.
Thank you, Dr. Ghosh. And I think the broad spectrum of the goals which SDG has is, everybody is well aware of having the 17 goals outlined, and we, given that we have to achieve them by 2030. So it's not too long that we have to achieve it. But I think of all SDGs, the way the think tanks, we are engaged in what our role is and what our role should be, I think the most important one is, as Arunabha said, is that what kind of ideas and knowledge we bring to the government, to the policymakers, and to take it, disseminate to the media. That's very important, because the ideas and the knowledge is the key ingredient of how you can achieve the SDGs, and where SDGs, where think tanks have most important role in. The second important thing is, the think tanks have the critical role in getting the disparate stakeholders together. So on one side, you have a layman who doesn't understand what policymakers are saying, and then you have science people, and then you have economists, and you have social science people. So how to bring all these disparate stakeholders together and establishing a kind of a narrative which takes the priorities further, I think that's very critical to achieve SDGs, and that's where our think tanks have a very critical role in doing that. I think third important thing is that how to prioritize these SDGs to the respective governments and decision makers. So it's not always that each government will look at SDGs as something which is of the one of the most important things they need to do. But how do you actually enable and push the envelope and to create consensus amongst the politicians, among the governments, and also the policymakers to prioritize and set the agenda, set a roadmap to how to achieve it. So that's very critical. I think when I look at my experience of think tanks and SDGs, I can talk about the as a part of IRADe, we are implementing partner of USAID in implementing South Asia Regional Initiative for Energy Integration, where we're working with South Asian countries to enable the power trade in South Asian countries. And as a part of that agenda, so we see that energy is the affordable energy and sustainable energy is SDG 7. And that's where we looked into how to actually push the SDG 7. And we think SDG 7 can actually enable several other SDGs to be achieved, whether we are talking about income, whether you're talking about jobs, whether you're talking about gender empowerment, whether you are talking about education, whether you're talking about healthcare. So I think when we look at our experiences, that how do we push the SDG 7 through enhancing the trade cooperation in the regional countries. So thereby we created another forum of think tanks, which is a forum of 22 think tanks in South Asia, where we're looking at the way we took the agenda further is that we engaged to produce a kind of a narrative through research, actually. So what are the priorities for how to prioritize the energy trade in the policies of these governments? So that was one. Then the kind of research which was brought through the engagement with the think tank, the second important a challenge was how to take this to the disparate stakeholders, which we took through consultations and dialogues with the politicians, citizens, civil society, academia. So all of that, we bringing them together, we further pushed this agenda. And the third is media. So through media engagement, we look at dissemination. So I think through these three pillars, we were able to see some clear transformation of the talks into the trade. So we saw that trade was being pushed through such engagement. The point is that while we talk about SDGs, I think the most important of SDG for me would be SDG 17, where we're talking about global cooperation. And the global cooperation is required, whether you're talking about achieving any other, whether it's a climate action, whether it's energy, whether it's education. So you need further south-north and again south-south partnerships to enable the SDGs. And I think that's very critical when we talk about. So I would say the think tank's priority should be to engage with other think tanks and to produce knowledge and also decision supporting tools to enable aid to the developing countries and building connections between the developed and developing countries, as well as developing to developing countries, to have those priorities and goals being transferred through ODA or other investments which can be brought for transformation and achievement of SDGs. So I would say that we think tanks have a very critical role to play to actually enable the platforms for collaboration, to produce new ideas, to exchange ideas, to use technology to transform, and dissemination. I think dissemination is something where think tanks are generally not well talked about. So I think to enable that outreach and dissemination, we definitely need to learn from each other, and also to have such collaborations from the developed world so that we actually work together to transform and achieve the SDGs. So I think these are my initial remarks, very broad remarks, to actually further for further debate and further to create further discussions. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you very much, Rohit. Dr. Panda, the Institute of Economic Growth was set up when India's overall economic growth was not very rapid. In the course of the several decades that IEG has been around, how do you see the development agenda having changed, and how do you then embed the SDG framework into the work that it does?
Thank you, Dr. Ghosh. So, as all of us know, when a country becomes independent and it has mass poverty, then obviously the first priority is growth. And India's development process has evolved through that. But historically also, if you see the developed world, what we call developed world today, even there, before industrialization or before the industrial revolution, bulk of the people, they lived in subsistence only. It is only later on that with growth, a better level of living came, and provision for education, health, and other things followed. In India also that happened. In fact, when IEG was established in the mid-50s, that time the country's agenda were the five-year plans. And in the beginning, in the first three or four plans, it was basically growth. The inequality, poverty aspects came into agenda of the country sometime around early 70s. But I would also say, you know, how think tanks have contributed, or they have been catalyst into this changing agenda. I would recall that when we are talking of poverty for last several decades, and I'm talking of income poverty or nutrition, some of the nutrition, particularly calorie-based poverty, it was one of the think tanks, the Gokhale Institute of Economics and Politics, where Professor Dandekar and Roth, they did a fairly rigorous analysis of measurement of poverty and also went to some of the policy prescriptions. And I remember, when I was a student then, the first time I was exposed to that paper was in Oriya. So it got translated within a year or two. It got translated to so many languages, at least part of it. And that created a kind of overall debate in the country on the poverty agenda, that growth and removal of poverty become the agenda of the government. And it so happened that we may call it populist, but Mrs. Gandhi also adopted it. Of course, you know, with a slogan that they would remove poverty, but, you know, it so happened every five-year plan after that talked of poverty removal within 15 years, and only possibly we can think of removal of abject poverty, $1.25, in another few years. Now, having told that, it is largely poverty removal has taken place largely in an atmosphere of growth. When the per capita income grew at almost double the earlier rate of about 1.5-2% up to 1980s, after the reforms, it almost doubled in per capita terms, or more than doubled. It is only then that we are able to make a big impact on income poverty removal. So that is one thing that possibly several think tanks, including the IEEG, have contributed towards that. They have been analyzing it. It is not only just the NSSO data, which were facts and other things we are talking about, but also collaborated with other local studies, where actually some of the constraints remain, that how to integrate, for example, the people living in remote tribal areas into the growth process. So some of these things have been highlighted. But also I would like to say that several think tanks, or not only just think tanks, but even, you know, what we may call professors in the universities, they have also brought out very strongly the relationship between growth and poverty. And earlier, if we are thinking that it is one versus the other, now possibly there is also a broad agreement that they are complementary to each other. It is, of course, you know, with the changing literature at the global level, also with the new growth economics, where the human capital aspects are emphasized. Human capital, not only for its, you know, education, not only for its intrinsic value, but also as an instrument of quality of labor. So these are some of the things that has taken place. Having told that, I'll just emphasize a couple of other points. For example, currently, if we see the overall welfare spending, where some of these MDG goals will come, in India, both by the federal government as well as the states, together, it is about 7% of GDP. So if we take out only the MDG component, most of it actually fall into one category or other, it will still be about 6 to 6.5% of GDP. If we have to make a big jump on achieving the international commitment that we have made by 2030, this needs to be increased by another 2 to 3% at least. How do we do that? Can we do it without increasing taxes? Can we do it by increasing the tax base without the tax rates? Or if we are not able to do either way, then possibly the government has to appeal to the private sector for funding in a big way. I think that is one critical area for, from MDG point of view, that several, you know, people have been pointing out that how do we do it? The CSR, the Corporate Social Responsibility Bill that we have, it calls for 2% of corporate profit to be spent on social responsibilities, other social sector or other issues, but mostly that has not been effective. My own view will be, it will be better to transfer it to a trust of the corporates and then spend it so that you can monitor them together. If you give 2% for each industry, for each firm, it is very difficult to monitor. On the other hand, if they contribute to a consortium like, you know, some of the industrial bodies, and they do it, it will be easy to monitor, and that can possibly make a big impact. I think few other things that, you know, we have been talking about neutrality and other things. Again, I'll go with one of the earlier speakers and say that what we need for credibility is rigorous analysis. It doesn't matter whether our analysis leads to policies of the left or right type. I'll give you one example. I used to work in the Indira Gandhi Institute of Development Research, Mumbai, where the pariks were there. At one stage, there were 3-4 papers on food subsidy, one opposing the other. You know, the people who were used to neoclassical analysis, who were arguing that we should not disturb the prices for efficiency ground, they were, of course, in favor of removal, or if not removal, reducing the food subsidy. On the other hand, others were telling that, no, without food subsidy, possibly you cannot reach out to the poor. We have to tolerate both the things. The point is, if one is doing serious study, if one is doing serious study, the other side cannot neglect. They have to look into it. Even if they have a different prescription, they have to come out with it. I think I like that. And the think tanks will prosper with, if they take that attitude. It is rigorous things. Similarly, for example, recently, a few years ago, we had the Forest Right Act. Again, for the tribals, possibly it meant a big thing, that it is for the first time it recognized that if we have to preserve our environment, particularly the forest, we have to involve the forest dwellers. Without that, it will not be possible. And if we involve that, they have a stake in guarding it also, because they are the people who have been, for centuries, they have been living in the forest. They know what to destroy and what not to. Basically, they use the minor timber. I think these are some of the issues. I do agree that think tanks have a big role in communicating it to the public. Right now, our emphasis often has been to the government, to the policymakers in the government. But of late, the way we have been discussing this morning, I feel that, you know, we have to communicate to the intelligent people who can observe certain things in the society, and that will be the force that will compel government to work towards different MDG goals. Priority-wise, I'll just make one point that I think I'll not go into climate change issues again. That is an international commitment, and we have to do whatever we can. But at the same time, if we speak of priorities right now, say jobs creation, particularly unskilled job creation, is a big priority, and that will help in meeting the MDG 1, poverty removal. Then education, health, and I'll add that the current emphasis on sanitation and hygiene, that's in the good direction. We should not have neglected it in the past. Without that, possibly the health issues cannot be tackled, particularly the communicable diseases. I think there are many other issues. We will come back. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Panda. One of the issues that consistently has been coming up in the earlier sessions, and both the speakers today have also in this session have mentioned it, is effective communication. So, which includes dissemination, but also the right audience. the question that arises in my mind is, you know, what is it that we are, I mean, before we develop the communication strategy, we should be clear about what it is that we are communicating. And is there a role for think tanks to allocate for themselves some precision in what they wish to be analyzing and then communicating? At CEEW, for instance, one of the things we emphasize a lot on is primary data. And we pride ourselves on collecting some of the, or collecting and then holding some of the largest data sets in the world, whether it's on energy access, whether it's on industrial emissions, and so forth. It's that body of primary data that allows us to talk not just to government in India, but to governments across the world, because we have more data than they do. But there's other aspects in which think tanks could become more relevant when we look at that entirety of the SDG chain. One of them is which level of governance we want to be having an SDG conversation at. Today, of course, we are convened in Delhi. But if you delve down to the state level, each state would use one of those 17 or a couple of those 17 as their primary hook. What Rohit was mentioning, you know, if SDG 7 energy is a driver of, say, regional integration, particularly in the east, our eastern states and then Nepal, Bhutan, et cetera, for a southern state, it might be different. To take an example, Andhra Pradesh has the world's largest program on what is called natural farming. Again, my organization has been involved in evaluating that program. It's reached 350,000 farmers, and the chief minister scaled it up, at least promised to scale it up to all 6 million farmers in the state. At that scale, even a failed experiment is a good lesson for the world. But the interesting thing is the lens they want to use is how will that one program impact all 17 SDGs. In fact, we've been evaluating how it'll impact all 169 indicators. The third way in which, so there's a question then, which think tanks are better attuned to be operating at that level of governance? And the third way in which think tanks, I think, should at least aim to carve some renewed role in the SDG space is in finance. So will it be public finance that will drive the growth versus poverty agenda, as was the case during the planning era? Would it be entirely private finance? Would it be blended finance? Would it be de-risked finance? These are questions that have not been resolved yet. And they've kind of actually been lumped into SDG 17 with a very nice terminology of partnerships. Actually, what we mean is money, right? So think tanks need to start forcing, if not carving, forcing their way in some of these specific areas on data and evaluation, on levels of governance, and on finance. At least that's the way we think of the SDG framework at the council. But let's, we definitely have about 45 minutes that we can allocate to discussion. So let's have two or three rounds of comments and questions. So who would like to go first?
Yes. Hello. So my name is Emma Hakalan. I'm from the Finnish Institute of International Affairs. But I was wondering, or I would like to hear maybe your opinions or points of view about this idea of degrowth and or otherwise than somehow fitting economic growth and all of these development targets together. Because I think at least in Finland there is increasingly, not maybe in the sort of political and government level, but in NGOs and think tanks and organizations, there is increasingly like talk about like whether we should give up this goal of constant economic growth, which maybe at least in a country like Finland, it somehow is understandable. But then for a country like India, which seems to really strongly depend on growth in order to meet its development goals, I think it's a completely different discussion. But then on the other hand, we know that in order, for example, to meet the targets of Paris Agreement and so on, we need to have some really significant changes. So I would like to hear your points of view on this topic. Thank you.
Anyone else? Bharat, and then I'll come to you, sir.
One of the things that's been missing, at least in the SDG conversations so far, is the interconnectedness between all of them. Historically, government departments have been attuned to picking interventions, choosing interventions that help certain parameters or indicators improve. And I think as think tanks, we have an opportunity to talk to them about how all of these things are interconnected. And I think in the past, apart from the example that you cited in Andhra and one of the projects in Tamil Nadu and another one in Maharashtra, most of them seem to be silo projects even now when it comes to SDGs. I think that it's going to be a missed opportunity if you don't think about the interconnectedness between them. And the second one with respect to SDGs is priorities. I think we tend to forget as think tanks that different stakeholders have different priorities with all of these. So how do you weave that in together? I think that model of using, I think that's when I talked about it in the morning, of using a trade-off paradigm instead of a this works best paradigm might be an interesting approach to think about different priorities for different stakeholders.
I think towards the end of the panel, Dr. Ghosh, raised a question about what are we communicating? You know, it's an important question in the sense of, you know, what should be the quality? Who are we reaching out to, et cetera, et cetera. In that context, I think what's become important today in today's environment is how are we communicating? In the sense, you know, that this morning also James brought out that nobody has time for reading books, journals, long articles. So, you know, I think this is where the challenge of the think tanks lie in terms of how fast are you able to communicate and how are you using the modern aids which are available. It's not that they're not using, they're already using it. But is there a strategy that you adopt, or is there some kind of a template that's universally adoptable? That's, of course, will be rapidly changing. You can't say this is the template, it will be valid for next 10 years. But are we in that kind of a situation where think tanks are proactive and trying to look at not just what are we communicating, but how are we communicating? How? What are the tools that we are using?
To look at the whole issue of think tank, are we also thinking of making these think tanks as economically viable? And in what sense will it work out? Because it is like if we take up the SDG goals, if we take up the SDG goals and the think tanks are operative, will that on its own, will it make it viable to get funds? Because it's solely dependent on the government how to fund. Because the think tank on their own do not have their fund to operate. It either come from the sponsors or from the government. So will there be a possibility that the economical viability of the think tank should be thought of for wider SDG goals?
I think the short answer is yes. Long answer is we don't know how. But let's come back to the panelists for comments on the other questions that have come up. I think I would like to come back to Elmer's question at the end, because that is at the core, because it's do we keep pushing for growth in the way we've narrowly defined it, or is there a different form of growth that is both politically sellable but also achieve some of the other objectives we have? But Bharat's question, interconnections, and you raised the social issue about priorities. How, not just what should we be communicating, but how should we be communicating? So if you could take on some of those questions.
Yeah, I'll take on the Bharat's question on interconnectedness. I think that's very important question, because when you are actually making an intervention, what implications it has on the, or what are the kind of, you know, the outcomes which are come that are not very clear even to the government. So because I am citing from my personal experience, so while we took up this, that how there is an interconnection between India and Bangladesh, where you have we are supplying power to Bangladesh from Behrampur to Behramara connection in Bangladesh. So we were, when initially it was thinking that how power can transform and, you know, have interconnection of SDGs, so we didn't have an answers. But we got an answer when we went to the villages, the bordering villages, which got electricity after you know, the electricity was supplied to those villages through this interconnection. So what we found when we talk about poverty or raising income, I think the first thing which came with electricity, there was 30% to 40% rise in the land prices. So you are making the people wealthy, and that was the first thing which just came with the spur of just having the electrification done in those villages. And then second was the communication. So people have mobile phones. So people were getting information about the opportunities or the better opportunities where they should work and where they should go for their daily wages or for the project livelihoods. So people, also the migration started towards, you know, better opportunities. And that was just one, electrification and electricity being brought. The third was that, which is really amazing in terms of clean cooking and gender, the woman shifted, a woman invested in purchasing the electricity, electric cookers, even in terms of, you know, they actually invested in getting those. Earlier they were cooking rice and they will collect firewood, and then that was activity which they were doing 3 times a day. And so, you know, that shifted. So you have gender empowerment, and then you have a clean cooking, and then you have better jobs, and you have better income, you are making them wealthy. And you have education, obviously you have a lighting and people, the indicators of primary education improved, and people started also investing, more people started joining schools. And obviously the primary health center, which was just opened during the day and didn't have any storage, refrigeration for vaccines or so, that started happening. So I think this interconnectedness is a definitely very important part of achieving SDGs, as well as communicating the importance of interconnectedness of the interventions. So I think that's fairly a ground example which answers your question.
I would just like to add that, you know, when we say priorities, we are not telling that the other parts should be neglected. It is just assigning the order. Order or weight. But I will also, you know, to illustrate, for example, gender equality is one of the MDG goals. Now, by now at least, in the last 20 years or so, it is very much well established in India also that if you empower the women, the outcome on child health and child education improves. So that way they are interconnected. Or as you heard in the morning, suppose the woman has ability to earn or to supplement the family income. And why supplement, even they could be the prime mover also. In that case, obviously the income poverty also will decline. I think this is the way we have to look at interconnectivity. So priority is only for limited purpose of maybe priority in the first 5 years will be one thing, the next 3 or 5 years will be another thing. But all of them have to be emphasized. The question about, you know, what to communicate, how to communicate, I think we agree that if we have to go to the wider mass, the communication has to be just a few paragraphs or a page or so. It cannot be more than a lead article in a newspaper. But at the same time, if you want credibility of the argument, a bigger paper which gives all the data, which tells how you have obtained your conclusions, that should be there, at least for the researchers who want to go into it. So that, because otherwise, people will ask, where is the evidence? So that should be there. It can be published somewhere else in a journal, in a book, or if not even that, at least keep it on the web page. So that will help you to establish credibility. But at the same time, I think most of the think tanks, particularly, I'm speaking from my own institute, they are not equipped with the modern communication mechanism. At best, we have we put our materials on the web. We have, also webcast some of our seminars. And we claim that, 9,000 or 10,000 people saw one seminar because they couldn't attend it in person. But beyond that, that is not going to help much. If you want more effective communication to wider mass, who will make an impact on policy, or who will start debating it day and night, then it has to be short communications with the social media. I think we have to move towards that in the next, the sooner we do, the better. Thank you,
sir. I think on the question of prioritization and interconnections, there's a danger that, nerds inhabiting Nerdville will come up with the most rational prioritization, and then we wonder why no one picked up on the idea. And this issue that Dr. Panda, the example he gave, is something I've been familiar with as well. When I was working as one of the authors of the Human Development Reports for the UN, we did some longitudinal work, from data from the 60s all the way. This is pre-SDG era, this is MDG era. And over the course of 4 decades, we saw that across the world, girls' education was the single biggest driver of all other MDGs, even though that time MDGs were not a framework. And I would hazard to propose that might be the case even in the SDG era. Now, that's the rational outcome. The political prioritization of that, and how do we go about communicating that and convincing the policymaker, not just the policymaker, the politician, that this is a worthwhile bet for political reasons, I think think tanks need to spend a lot more time on that. Because that's the disconnect between the rational intervention and what we claim is the irrational political choice. But the politician thinks they're making a rational political choice against an irrational set of technocratic advice. So it's very critical. That's why not just the how to communicate, but the what to communicate becomes very critical. And to that question about should we push only for growth, I think that's what my earlier comments were about, that for a country like India, we cannot abandon growth. This is not, I don't think any country actually is in its heart really abandoning growth. We can couch it in all sorts of language. The real question is, what will be the new drivers of growth? And can sustainability be a new driver of growth? Sustainability not in terms of just hugging trees, but real sustainability, whether it's in renewables, whether it's in building design, whether it's in how water is managed, whether it's in how aircraft are manufactured, whether it's on how critical minerals are recycled. All those drive new added value to the economy, except we are not embedding it that way. We're thinking of sustainability as a separate line item in our budgetary activity. Yeah. Let's do another round of questions. Who would like to go? Yes, please introduce.
Yeah, this is Amardeep Singh from CUTS International. So the think tanks, think tank and SDGs and our role and the space scope for our intervention, as I see, at national level, we have Niti Aayog as a the nodal agency for planning to set some agenda for the ministries or department at national level. So Niti Aayog is doing that at national level, but state level we don't have, most of the state don't have any nodal agency other than the departments who are looking at SDGs. So there we have scope for think tanks to intervene and to analyze, to do the analysis of these SDGs and its implementation with the several departments and ministries and all. Other than that, the municipal corporation, we are talking about when we talk about local governance and all. So the municipal governance or the cities or the city's development is very important part of SDGs. But unfortunately, in India, our municipal governance or local governance, especially urban local governance, is not that much empowered or equipped with the capability or capacity to implement SDGs. So there again, we have a scope for working for think tanks. So just to add into that.
Yes, please.
Yeah, just to add, I think now it's been a mandate by Niti Aayog to have nodal cells. So I have a feeling at least 20 to 25 states have set up nodal SDG cells, at least in Telangana, I know. But the problem is they have not set it up with the government. They've done it with a state training institute. So which brings to the other argument about the economic viability. They are looking for funds. We are also trying to look for funds. So where do you go from there? So, but there are work happening, but mostly from a capacity building. So what they do is there are state nodal cells training the different departments about the SDG goals, what is SDGs. That sort of activities are going on.
And sir, you're from which state?
I'm from Telangana Administrative Staff College.
That's right. Can I nudge? Yes, I'll just come to you. And while the others are thinking, could those of you who are not from India to also reflect on how are think tanks engaging with the SDG agenda in your home countries? But also those, I'm already delighted that, you know, think tanks from Chennai, Telangana, et cetera, have spoken. I think, sir, you've come from the Northeast. If you could again reflect on whether the SDG agenda at all is showing up on the kind of governance agenda overall. But sir.
I think we should be honest, I think. Things don't go beyond Delhi. We talk so much here, and I think only state Niti Aayog. I should not speak much about Niti Aayog, but what I would say is that think tanks should not be depending on Niti Aayog or any other Aayog. Think tanks should have their own army of researchers. But it's a question of creating alternatives. If it depends wholly on government, then we get the same results which we have been getting so far. And I think it's high time that we don't pledge, you know, our capabilities to these government organizations. That is one. Number two, what is happening in governments? In governments, we make a paper, and somebody, I think, Professor Panda rightly spoke. What happens in the government is that we come out with a paper, but that paper is far removed from the ground realities. Unless we take ground realities into consideration and go there, and then we prepare a paper that will make a sense. I give an example that we say, I think, I give the case of Urisa from where Panda Sahib comes from. We did some research over there that climate change affects agriculture. Now, it doesn't make, you know, doesn't cut any ice with the farmer. With a man, no layman in the street there. It doesn't go beyond the files. And that can keep the officers engaged from morning to evening and whole bureaucracy, and I think, you know, media and all that. But we took, I think, sample of two villages. And then we did a survey, and then we then showed them what were the impact of the climate change on the per acreage production of rice, per acreage production of fruits and the vegetables. And, you know, that was the hard evidence. Therefore, I think in the government can be a way to run administration, but government can't do research. And the agencies which governments have created, you know, so far, I think there may be a few exceptions here and there, the kind of research which should have come from there is not coming. And therefore, the results that we make on that research, our policies, they just go astray. Now, there is one more thing in that when we talk of prioritization, which is a very important issue you told, who should do? And I think we just can't again generalize, because what happens is that we generalize, then we get lost, I think. We don't come to the real, you know, bit of the problem. In my view, I think now, you are seeing that you asked the question on growth. Most of the growth is coming from the industrial houses in this country. And at this rate, I think 68 to 70% money will be coming from industrial houses, either through manufacturing or it will come through services. Now, given that, I think we must consider to ask them. They make a profit, but I think we should ask them to create an alternative kind of balance sheet. Are they really making profit? And if you do that, those things to consideration, we must show them the face, I think. They may agree or disagree. This is the question, I think, which our think tank should do. We must prepare an alternative balance sheet and then say that this is not the profit. You are endangering, I think, the species. You are endangering, you know, our forest. You are pushing us, I think, in the fireball.
Sure.
That kind of thing we should do. Unfortunately, what has happened is that we have not been doing that. And we just get lost in the evaluation of the government schemes.
Yeah.
We evaluate because we get funded. That is a very important issue. And here I'll just, I think, make a point to, which Dr. Panda made. It's absolutely wrong to say that CSR has a lot of funds. We must be very honest in telling here, you go to CSR, Article 135, and see a Schedule 7. And when Schedule 7, you see, it started with 5 subjects. And today we have made it 15 subjects. And 80 to 90% of the CSR money is going to government programs. And you have been knowing how government spends the money. What is the output of that? What is the, you know, reach of that? What is the impact of that? Total failure, I think. So there was a good program which came under Companies Act, but has been very badly, I think, you know, understood and implemented.
Sure.
Government should withdraw from there. Government should not be there. That money should go to the local people, should go to the people around. Government should just come out.
Sure, sir.
And there is a partnership between government agencies and, you know, the industrial houses.
Yeah.
They misuse the money. And we talked of, you know, this trust.
Yeah.
Trust misuse the money.
Sure.
I should not go. I think I'll just take half a minute to take Mr. Antle's case. We create.
So let's leave the examples for the tea break. Let's collect a few more interventions because we need to close at 4:15. Yes, sir.
Thank you very much, sir. Since you have asked me to say a few things from Northeast, I would like to say from few things about Northeast on think tank. Well, morning. My colleague from Patna, he said there are two think tanks in India. One is funded by government of India, funded by the government. The other one is private. Now in Northeast we have two government-funded things. One is ICSR Northeastern Regional Center, which I am representing. The other one is Omiyakumar Das Institute for Development Studies, based in Guwahati. And apart from that, we have number of private intellectuals. They have started think tanks. They are vibrant in their own respective states. But I've often come across that they are struggling a lot. Financially, it's very difficult for them to run a think tank without any financial assistance for them from different agencies. So that's a big problem what we face in Northeast India. And as you know, Northeast India is a virgin field for our researchers. And we have 99% of our border with neighboring countries. So we have more with the neighboring countries culturally, anthropologically, ethnically, and socially in different aspects. Of course, politically, we are linked with India's mainland India. Now, what I want to say about the SDG, regarding this particular aspect, Sikkim has done fantastic. And most of you know who have an economic background, Sikkim has brought out a state development report. Likewise, other states, including the state from which I'm coming from, Meghalaya and Assam, and other states also, they have brought out state development report. But we are far behind the schedules, what has been fixed for us. Now, many other initiatives are needed. In fact, the think tanks, what we have, all are Delhi-based, or in Bangalore, or in Hyderabad, or Chennai. And it would be nice for Professor James to think of having a forum or an event in Guwahati or in Shillong. We do have facilities which we can extend for you in our university. Thank you.
We perhaps have time for just one intervention before we go back to the panelists. Anyone? Okay, so let's go in reverse order. Dr. Okay. Panda.
Yeah, first with the last point, I think the Northeast does need some independent think tanks. Some of them are there, like Amya Kumar Bakshi or your own, you know, ICSR Center. But if most of the, you know, young people, even from the Northeast, they have a preference to work in Delhi because of their career opportunities, how do you reconcile? I think one of the ways to reconcile will be at least call them for a couple of years, let them do some work there, or let them do work on Northeast from Delhi in collaboration with some of the institutes. And I have no two opinion that given the size of the Northeast, it needs more think tanks. Professor Mishra's point, you know, yes, we need to bother not only about the funding from private sector. They should be independent. They should not go. They should not be taken as going through the government. It should be independent so that at least we have independent interventions as per the perceived need of the locality or of the society. I think the point is they should spend. If they don't spend and they only ask for test concessions, which might be needed on competitive ground, but if they don't spend part of their profit or the culture of giving they don't develop, I fear given the current nature of the growth process, there will be social backlash. And that is exactly, you know, if it happens after 10 years or 15 years because government is not able to spend on SDGs, that will be a bad thing. That will derail the growth process itself. And I think social stability or instability rather, social instability will be the biggest threat to sustainable growth, not in the short run, but in the long run. And I do also agree that we need to grow at least at 7 to 8%, if not more, for about 2 to 3 decades. We have to reach that level, at least the world average level, before possibly we can afford to slow down. There are obviously bigger questions on limits to growth, carrying capacity and all that. But whatever it is, it's a dynamic world. We have to, the absorption capacity of different, you know, environmental degradation, that's also changing. With technology, it will change. And we have to, you know, I'll only say one more thing, that we should not be afraid of environment, all the SDGs as something that is reducing growth. Rather, if we focus on the right way, it will possibly be the new engines of growth. I think at the state level, I do, you know, agree that states have been engaging different local think tanks on some of their programs, but they are very, very limited for one or two programs, and the states need to come out with a broader documents which can supplement Niti Aayog, and at the same time, we have to remember that it is not that Niti Aayog does all the thinking for the government. They do depend on several other agencies. They have a big machinery, but at the same time, they do depend on several things that they cannot do. Yeah, I think these are some of the things.
Yeah, I think whenever we talk about SDGs and achieving them at national level, they are just goalposts. But all the actions and action plans have to come from the state. So obviously states, I would say, have more critical role, and state think tanks have actually a lot of space to actually enable the governments to achieve, to further make an assessment of what policies are actually, you know, complementing, what policies are leading to that, where we fall short of. It will all come from states. Nothing will happen in the center on that. So I think if the space to actually engage and work and to also innovate, it lies at state level. So I think states have very critical role in terms of achieving those SDGs, or either we talk about NDCs for that matter from the climate action point of view. What at the same time, I think it raised a very important question on cities' capacity. So when you go to the cities, they will be just, they will be actually engaged in the firefighting only in terms of, you know, the making the services available to the citizens on a very firefighting mode. So there are no such priorities in terms of when we talk about sustainability, sustainability actions at the city level. Even their budgets doesn't allow. There is no talk about it actually. So I think equally at city level, you need to have more engagement and of think tanks and also the ways to, you know, partner and enable financing where there is a critical role to do that. So in terms of both knowledge, action and financing, the states and city governments have a very important role to achieve, you know, to further push achievement of SDGs, and think tanks have a very important role to do.
Thanks. Thank you, Dr. Panda. I think on this issue of think tanks should build up their own army of researchers, I mean, that should, without doubt, be, you know, primary motivation for our existence. If we don't have our own independent analysis to offer, then why are we around? You know, and that, of course, then raises questions of economic viability, et cetera, which is why finding alternative funding models is absolutely critical. But the other issue that came up in your comments is the need to engage with industry, not just to kind of show them a mirror, but to find alternative business models where you're not locked into a paradigm where it's growth or sustainability, however you define it. Again, at CEEW, that's one of the things we do extensively, working with industries, working with utilities to develop business models that demonstrate economic viability for their balance sheets. But I would still want to conclude on generally a more positive note. You know, 1972, the first UN conference on environment and development in Stockholm, there was a famous speech by Prime Minister Indira Gandhi where she said, "Isn't poverty the worst polluter?" And that was a time when environment and development, they were the two different paradigms that we used to think about. We're a long way ahead since then. That statement held value then, but that we are ourselves thinking about poverty in a multidimensional manner, that we're thinking of development in different ways, that we're thinking of viability and sustainability, not just of the environment, but of society and the economy and of politics, itself suggests that we've kind of found some sort of a middle ground, and it's up to us to kind of take that agenda forward. So on that count, and we conclude, and once again, thanks, Jim, for giving us this opportunity.
Okay, we're back on track, and a fully reconstituted break is available.